Hello, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Exotic Astrology. And after many requests on Panchang, we have Anuradha Sharda with us again here. And today she's going to share some amazing insights on Panchang. I'm also very excited to see. Welcome back to Exotic Astrology. Great to have you. So please tell us, what are you going to share about Panchang today? People are very enthusiastic and eager to hear from you. Please tell us.
Thank you so much, Bhavajit. Today, I'm going to take up one chart, a very current chart, Donald Trump, and I'm going to show you what makes him the person that he is just by using the elements of the Panchang. What is the Panchang? There are five elements in there. Vara, that is the day on which you are born. Tithi, that is the relationship between the lunar day and between the lunar and the solar calendars, or rather the sun and the moon. And then there is Karna, which is half of the Tithi. Then there is Nakshatra. Nakshatra most people know, so I don't need to explain that in detail. And then there is Yoga, which is different from the daily yogas that we see in the charts. It is known as the Nitya Yoga. Now, we have been using this Panchang from time immemorial. We have always used it for Muhurta. Nakshatra is again used to find out about, you know, the marriage matching and things like that. But that's just the tip of the iceberg. The Panchang in itself is a total analysis. And just the Tithi that you are born, the Karna that you are born, the Vara that you are born, everything will give you your relationships, your professional life, the kind of protection that the universe has to offer to you, your mental life framework, your energy in life, everything. And it is also used for timing of events. So what we have considered till date only to use for Muhurta or marriage matching has a scope beyond our imagination. And today, that is something I would like to share with all of you just by looking at the chart of Donald Trump. What makes him the man that he is? And finally, there's an interesting fact coming up called Tithi Pravesh. So what is Tithi Pravesh? On your birthday, what happens is that is on the same Tithi that is formed, you know, in the Vedic calendar as the time that was formed when you were born. The Tithi that was when you were born, the same Tithi with the placement of the sun and moon in the same place. That very day, when you draw a calendar for one calendar year, from that day to the next year, that is called the Tithi Pravesh. That is, Pravesh means getting in. So when that particular Tithi moves in your chart for one calendar year, that is known as the Tithi Pravesh. And that describes as to what is going to happen in your life for one whole year. So it's a amazing concept, and that can be used to time events also in one year, in that particular year. So what's going to happen in a particular month, because there are 12 months and the 12 houses of the calendar of the chart, and then what's going to happen in one particular month every year can be shared, can be shown, anything. So we will also basically timing of events can be done with all the five elements, but I would just, because it will be too lengthy session, so I'd just be sticking on to seeing who he is and what he is and why he is like that. And apart from that, I'll take up Tithi Pravesh just to show what is, how it manifests in his life the way it does. So should I get started with it, and I'll just take you across,
yes, the stage is all yours.
So we'll move on to Donald Trump, a complete Panchang analysis. So he's born on Purnima, okay? And the Vara that he is born on is Friday. There are 16 Tithis which are in repetition. 15 plus Purnima, and then again 14 and Amavasya. So there are 14 14 plus Purima, again 14 plus Amavasya. So in total, we have 30 Tithis, effectively 12 of a kind, 14 of a kind, and then one each. Vara is Friday. So we have 7 days of the week, 7 planets associated with it. Karna is Bhava. There are 11 Karnas, and Bhava, Ballava, Kaulava, Taitula, like this, there are 11 Karnas, and Bhava is the first one. Okay. Nakshatra is Jeshta. And yoga, that is the Nitya Yoga, that is formed by the combination, addition of the longitude of the sun and the moon, is known as Shubha Bhava. So who is Donald Trump? We all know who he is, but just a revision here. He's an American businessman, television personality, author, and politician who is the 45th and current president of the United States in office since January 2017. He holds the distinction as the oldest person ever elected to the presidency, also the wealthiest man. He made a fortune estimated at $1 billion by finding and losing, buying losing properties and turning them around. So restructuration was his fundamental work, his basis. The fourth of the five kids, he grew up in Queens, and he's the son of a self-made millionaire in real estate. In 1968, he graduated from business school. In 1975, he made his first purchase of a rundown hotel and began his history of renovations. So now let us take up Vara analysis. What is Vara analysis? He's born on a Friday. So let's see what the classic texts, all that I have here are from classic texts, what the classics have to say, be it Mangalsari, be it Hora Ratnam, be it Yavna Jataka, or be it Jatak Parijata. So all of them have a say here. One born on Friday will indulge in secretive acts, be benevolent, intelligent, and righteous in deeds. He will have a wide knowledge of the affairs of the world, be an expert in art and scriptures, and be pure. Well, this is what the classics have to say. There will be a lot of modulation depending on the associations of the Vara Lord. One born on a Friday will be fickle-minded, a critique of gods, that is, he will be rationalist. He will acquire wealth, be fond of sports, intelligent, charming, and a good orator. Yavana Jataka states that he will be involved in discreet activities, be charitable, intelligent, and perform religious activities, will be skilled in art and scriptures. Jatak Parijata moves on to say that he will possess lands and wealth. He would be famous the world over, and he would be brave. Now, all these planets, all these distinctions, say supposing we're talking about Vara here. Vara means it is ruled. The fundamental element ruling it is fire, because the day that you're born gives you a lot of fire in you. It provides the impetus for you to work. It provides that energy, and hence it is ruled by Mars. So Mars is one fundamental planet that is common to all the 7 days. Apart from that, Friday becomes a lord of this planet. Now let us take up the Vara in case of Donald Trump. These people are beautiful, they're handsome, they like to wear white, have a very rare intelligence, are artistic, and have an eye for beauty and creativity. They try to follow the good path and are worldly yet secretive. If Venus is weak, they can be super critical and spoil their ability to admire beauty. Please note this fact. A weak Venus still gives them the ability to appreciate beauty, but they can set such high standards that they do not feel that anybody can live up to it, and they may feel unhappy perpetually. as we go on to the Hora analysis, because Vara has a part to it, that is Hora. What is Hora? Everybody we know is born in a particular hour, and at that hour there is, as per the Hora chart, some planet which is operating or which has a say command over that particular hour. 12 horas in the daytime, 12 horas in the nighttime. When he was born, the Hora in operation was Sun. The Hora of the Sun, person belonging to the Hora of the Sun wants to be strong and powerful, and they have to find their own place in the world. They act with energy, strength, courage, and a sunny nature. They aspire for positions of strength, but the problem arises if the day lord is Saturn, that is Vara lord is Saturn, and then that oppresses the sun while vitality. Here we have the Hora lord is Sun, and that day lord is Venus. So because the day lord is Venus, there is a water element to the fire element of Sun. This creates an imbalance. Sometimes he's too hot, sometimes he's too cold. And let us see how it is going to reflect in his chart. So in his chart, we find that Venus is associated. Venus here is associated in the 12th house as the Lord, and Sun in the 10th house. Sun, as we know, is strong in the 10th house, very strong, because it gets Digbali in the 10th house. And being in the 10th house, that is in the sign of the Taurus, and being the Lagna Lord, because his Lagna is Leo, being the Lagna Lord and Mars, the Lord of the Dina or the day, that he's element of the day, sitting right there in the Lagna. Lagna again is a fiery sign. Huge amount of energy, even at this age, born in 1946. So even in this age, you know, he is raring to go. And working, I mean, okay, as a president. And he's raring to go. So there's a lot of strength, vitality in him. And Sun in the 10th house again, and sitting is very strong, sitting in the sign of Venus. There is a compatibility. Venus is sitting in a water sign, and so Venus is extremely watery. So he has his emotions, you know, he's more governed by impulses and emotions rather than what is objective and what can be done and what should be done. Venus also represents, Venus would also represent the ladies. So in his workplace, he would definitely have a lot of ladies around. As we move forward in the Vara analysis, we will have seen that Sun, which is again the Lagna Lord, is sitting with Rahu. Rahu being the element of suddenness, changeness. So these changes, these sudden activities will definitely come from time to time. There would be instances when he would not know what he's saying. His energy levels would also be moving upward only because Sun is vitality and Rahu always has an increasing factor. So the earthy content in him would be increased with age. Before he became the president, he was undergoing a lot of examination by a number of doctors, and even in spite of his age of 70 plus, he was totally fit to be a doctor, to be a president. He had absolutely no problems. Given his lifestyle also, he didn't have problems, because Mars, which is the element of Vara, sitting right there in his Lagna again a fire element, and Sun, his Hora Lord, and Venus are in good position to provide him with that vitality. So let us move forward with Karana. he is born in a Bhava Karna. What do you mean by Bhava Karna? Before I move on here, I would again like to state that Karna has an element of Mercury, and Karna is one area through which one would know their profession. It is a huge ability to be able to spot out how a person will be able to work, how a person will be able to do in his profession, just by looking at the Karna of a person and the placement of a respective planet, Mercury, and knowing about the deity of the Karna. This in itself is a huge, you know, link, or rather a huge, this is indication to let us know how a person in life is going to unfold in his profession. So Bhava people born are more after success and power. They are good leaders, they're scholarly and passionate, but a afflicted son can depict arrogance, despondency, poor leadership quality, and a need for, you know, support, sustenance. These people should keep adding new techniques and innovation methods to their work. Change from time to time would do them good, and they should maintain a steady flow of water in their workplace. They should collect rainwater, and this is, if there is some kind of affliction on the sun or Mercury, particularly in case of the people born under Bhava Karna, this will actually go a long way in strengthening your Karna, your Mercury, and as such bring about a change for the good in your professional life. Work related to water will bring them good success, and keeping an aquarium because it all relates to sun. And it's easy to remember because the deity here is Lord Vishnu. Lord Vishnu stays right there in the midst of the Kshir Sagar, or the cosmic oceans, surrounded by water all around. A person born in Bhava Karna will be extremely lustful or intoxicated, liberal, rich, and happy. He will discard religious or righteous conduct, be lordly, and head of an army. So it's not me saying, it's Horaratna 2 of chapter 2, Effects of Karna, Bhava Karna, shloka number 581. This is what is said in Horaratna. Let's just see how this unfolds for our esteemed person here, Donald Trump. His son, Mercury, are what we need to say. Now, what does Lord Vishnu give him? Lord Vishnu gives him the ability to negotiate. Lord Vishnu is a great negotiator. Ability to negotiate. Lord Vishnu gives him the ability to keep all his ears to the ground, finding out, working on the principles of Sam Dam Danda Bhed, that is, coming to get people around, either by bribing them, either by making them your friends, either by talking to them, or either by the fear of punishment. There have been many cases of litigation against him wherein he's actually gone ahead and done physical harm to people who have not paid debts of his casino or of his hotels. There have also been cases against him wherein he has won those cases, and he has been very aggressive in doing so. Now let us see why he has been aggressive in doing so. Where is Sun placed? Sun is again placed in his 10th house. Very formidable position, like I told you. Again, it is associated with Rahu. Rahu does help you do. It gives you an impetus. In fact, it gives you an upthrust. This Sun, it gives it an upthrust to do as much as possible in his profession. But this Rahu walking on a lower octave can make him do things that are beyond the scope of legitimacy. He would be deviating into things which are not legal. This is what this Rahu does. By hook or by crook, he has to be the greatest person on that land. Mercury, again, Mercury here is in its own house and it's in the 11th house. 11th house is Upachaya house. 11th house is the greatest house if concerned, because that gives a person a lot of abilities, accomplishments. Negotiation, contracts are a part of Gemini sign, and Mercury is good at it. Sitting there, right in its own sign, in the 11th house of contracts and contacts, this Mercury gives him great space to work his way into the world of business and finally land himself into the most prestigious position of the land, that is, as the president of the land. Tithi analysis. So when we move to the Tithi analysis, we see that as per Mangasari, chapter 1, effects on the birth on Purnima. A person born on Purnima will possess property, be learned, fond of women, and industrious by nature. He will be desirous of other women. As per Yavan Jataka, he will have bountiful of things, stable success, be contented, exceedingly felicitous, and a noble person. As per Jatak Parijata, he will uphold family prestige and be opulent and delightful. A person born on Purnima will possess an abundance of things, will have steadiness of fortune, ever satisfied, highly fortunate, and highly virtuous. So, in effect, when we have seen the Vara, when we have seen the Karana, the wealth factor has been great. Vara has told us that he's extremely vital. Vitality he has in spades. Karna said that he would reach great heights as far as his profession was concerned. Now, there's a method to time to find out when he would be able to do so. That would be taking the session into quite a long time. That is to be taught in the classes. So, but interestingly, we will do the Tithi Pravesh to see. The coming times may not be as beautiful for him as it had been earlier on. So, Tithi is all about relationships. Tithi is all about our ability to garner wealth. The planet associated with Tithi is Saturn. And as I told you, there's a planet associated with every Tithi. The deity is the full moon. And the division of the Tithi is Puna. There are five divisions: Nanda, Bhadra, Jaya, Rikta, and Puna. And they are associated with five different planets. The luminaries not included. What are the luminaries? The sun and the moon. So, barring that, we have Nanda associated with Mars, Bhadra associated with Mercury, Jaya associated with Jupiter, Rikta associated with Venus, and we have finally Puna associated with Saturn. So here we see the element of Saturn is, or planet Saturn plays a very important role as far as his relationship and his wealth is concerned, because Tithi provides us a huge background for wealth and relationship. And the element is water. It is associated with Venus. Now let us move back into his chart and see what Venus and relationships have to say for us. When we are talking about his chart, we'll have to see what relationships and wealth can do for him. Saturn. Saturn is sitting right there in the 12th house with Venus. Saturn is very important for him as far as his relationships is concerned and as far as his wealth is concerned. Saturn is the lord of his 6th house and the 12th house and sitting, 6th house and the 7th house and sitting in the 12th house. When Saturn, as the lord of the 6th house, what does the 6th house have to say? For everything. 6th house is extramarital affairs. 6th house is employees. 6th house is rules and regulations that you as an employer put in the workplace. Sixth house is all about discipline. Sixth house is also women. Sixth house is hidden enemies. Sixth house is fraudulent activities. Sixth house is litigation. Sixth house is court cases and scandals. And then we have the seventh house of public platform, open enemies. And we also have our conduct across the wide platform. Twelfth house relates to international fame. 12th house also relates to mistresses. 12th house also relates to international travel, and it also relates to imprisonment. It also relates to banishments. So much for Saturn and Venus. Now let us see how all of it can be got together. He has been known to take in people, to remove people, and not on basis of the caste or creed, but mostly on levels of low payment, not good behavior with employees. Let's talk about Venus sitting there with that Saturn. In his workplace, he's been known, and he has on record and gone and said that he would grab women and just start kissing them. He has gone on record. It's there in the Wikipedia. And when he was running for the office of president, there were as many as 15 to 16 women coming out and talking about sexual harassment against him in his sixth house. And then again, as per Saturn, he has had two very ugly divorces which have cost him, because it's the sixth house of legal activities. He'd had extramarital affair, as a result of which he had to pay a lot of alimony to his first wife to get married to his then girlfriend and later on wife. This Saturn is the lord of the sixth house. Aspecting the sixth house makes sure that he pays for his mistakes. We'll see how this Saturn plays a very important role in his chart as such. And that will also be the reason why we can plot that this is the time when he will be facing a lot of problems. This Saturn is again the lord of his seventh house, which is six houses away from the seventh house, creating a lot of issues, legal entanglements in his public persona. There has been way too many scandals against him. Even his win was not said to be a very fair and square one. There are rumors that he has, you know, hired people to make sure that he had won. 12th house would mean international fame. It would mean defamation also. Sitting with the 10th lord of profession, we'll see how it converts on later. So Saturn again, here it's not complete. There has been times when there were a lot of allegations on him earlier on, right from the start of his business. There had been times when he was told that there has been a lot of allegations, and as such, he decided not to work for. There had been a lot of allegations against him, you know, and so there was a method for him to counterattack these allegations and create a lot of pressure on the person counting them and get away scot-free. As far as his wealth is concerned, he's gone into bankruptcy four times. Not him. Laws are such that he would not go into bankruptcy, but his casinos or hotels could go into bankruptcy four times. He's a multi-billionaire. And yet, his casinos, and he has on record again said, the bankruptcy laws are good for me. I like to play with them and they provide me with the debt trimming. So again, the wealth factor is again here, if we know, is again a little dicey on the side. It does create a lot of malefic effects. Women we have seen have had a lot of issues with him, a lot of acrimony against him. So relationships and wealth are subjected to a lot of cover if you take the radar. Now we move on to the nakshatra here. Nakshatra analysis. When I'm doing the nakshatra analysis, while doing in our class, we take up a lot of parameters, but here, because it's just a small part of the total, we'll be taking just the four elements. For nakshatra, the deity is Indra, the planet associated, his moon is placed in Jyeshtha Nakshatra. Jyeshtha Nakshatra deity is Indra. His symbol of that nakshatra is circular amulet, and it can be an umbrella, it can be a earring. And the planet which rules the Vimshottari Dasha of Jyeshtha is Mercury. The element associated with that of nakshatras in general is Saturn, and that is the air. So it also defines your mental attitude. Air is very quick. It is very swift in its approach, and it defines what your mental attitude is all about. So when we're talking about Jyeshtha, what we are doing here is taking the deity, okay, into consideration. The deity into consideration is Indra. He is the eldest of the all the gods. And he is very egoistic. He is very authoritative. He is very indulgent. He is very dominating. He is fond of power. He has a lot of addictions. Well, for our Donald Trump, he doesn't have any addiction. But yet he has an addiction. He has an addiction for money, and he has an addiction for power. And he does have a very lustful eye on the opposite gender, that is the ladies.
No comments.
Yeah, no comments. But then it said, it's out there in the Wikipedia. I'm not stating anything on my own.
Yeah, that is why I said no comments.
Competitive. He's highly competitive. He's very competitive. And there's a huge amount of nervous energy. And we'll see how it all works out when with Mercury. When we're talking about an umbrella, what does an umbrella do? It provides protection. It gives person a consolidation. That is, it brings, we say that you bring everything under one umbrella. When it is like getting, cover, protection, and it is also about guardianship. It is a modifier. It is also a royal patronage, because in the earlier times, when the royalty would walk, even today, they have an umbrella, somebody holding an umbrella over their head. Now, we will need to go back to his chart, and we will see. Here, I have Donald Trump's chart again here. Saturn is the element of the nakshatras, and Mercury again is the lord of planet that is associated with Jyeshtha. We'll see how it fires out. Now, Saturn is the sixth lord, again the seventh lord, and Mercury is his 11th lord and the second lord. These lords are connected to wealth. I've already given you points out there which will actually tell you how and what it is all about. He is a very dominating personality. In fact, being the fourth of the five children born to his parents, yet he succeeded his father's empire. How did he do so? His elder brother died of alcoholism. And that told him that he's not going to touch alcohol. So he doesn't have any alcohol addiction or a drug addiction. But the addiction to power is no less. Indra also has a very strong addiction to power. It is known in the Puranic stories that Indra would not let go of his throne. He would do anything to hold on to his throne. So that becomes a very interesting thing to see. He has done everything possible. And as per WikiLeaks and other things, as per, a lot of litigations against him, it is said that the way he's got his, crown, throne or his presidency is not fair and square. It's not legal. Again, Saturn Mercury is in the 11th house. 11th house, as I stated earlier, is the Upachaya house. And that Upachaya house is great for him. How does it plan out being great for him? Because it's a planet in its own house, and that gives him an ability to grow from person to person. Mentality is again through Saturn and Mercury. Mercury, 11th house is the house of gains. Mercury sitting in the house of gains and in its own house, anything. Mercury is also a karaka for trade. Anything which is trading, anything that gives him money, he is willing to move into that area, earn that money. Doesn't bother much about the consequences. He is authoritative, willing to put his authority anywhere that he wants to work on that, and he is not bothered about the consequences. Again, as we see, when we're talking about, he was protected by his father right from the word go. Son, again, the karaka of father sitting with Rahu, they have together in the house of business done a lot of things that is not savory, that's not done with, not dealt with. The IRA, his the revenue systems and the taxation systems in their country have a lot to say for the father and son duo. Yet he was protected under various guise of tax rebates and things like that by his father. So there is a protection, there is an umbrella over him, somebody to give a mark on his shady activities. He is highly competitive, we have seen that. Then ego, and what makes him the eldest, what makes his voice being heard across the nation. The throne, as you've seen, works for him like no other addiction. Finally, we come to the major part, that is the Shubha Yoga. If you're born in a good yoga, trust me, you can have issues in life, but you would always be protected. Yogas, the Nitya Yogas, are under the preview of Jupiter. Jupiter is the most expansive planet of our solar system. And how does it protect us? There are certain yogas that give you protection, that give you luck. There are certain yogas that give you a lot of ability to do whatever you want, and yet you come out very, very well. And then you have, like, you, and there are certain yogas like the Vajra Yoga, like, so these yogas, what they do is they actually do not provide that protection, no matter how good the other factors are. But if the yoga is not very well, the person literally has to constantly be at odd with the other elements in life to prove his or her mettle. Even if they did prove their mettle, they could have problems, being accepted by others. The feeling of being alone and not being accepted is majorly due to the attribution of the yoga. Because I remember very well, we have the Nobel Prize winner, two-time Nobel Prize winner, the only lady to have done so, Marie Curie. She has one of the yogas, the Vetipathi Yoga, which actually does not provide with so much of protection. So in spite of all that she achieved in life, good relation, everything, but she had to struggle for it every step of the way. And even after she went there, she was not accepted by the Science Institute of France just because she was a lady. There is absolutely no consequence, no regard for the fact that she has won two Nobel Prize. She's a lady, she is not taken up. That is the beauty of the yoga. It will actually tell you how strong or how beautiful your covering in life is. It's like a kavach. It's like a protection. It's like an armor that the yoga provides to you. People who are born in the Shubha Yoga are very fortunate. Writers, bereft of anger, very pure, modest, and will cause happiness to others. Well, that is what Hora Ratnam has to say. when we're looking about the general thing, it is said generally, you know, that they should maintain a balance in their work and they should extend the benefit of it to others around them. And you know what? Today I was reading and what I found out, this person would run a non-profit, and out of that non-profit, he would buy a painting of himself worth $20,000. So that non-profit is for others. It is supposed, you're supposed to help others with that non-profit. And what do you end up doing? You end up buying a picture of your own self. So here, he's supposed to maintain a balance in work and to help others. He's not helping anybody. He's just getting it all on himself. They should not resort to illegal, unethical, and antisocial behavior to increase profits in their work. That is a must no-no. And I mean, Donald Trump is the most current topic. So everybody would know lots about him without me going much more about his personal deeds into details. So let's see, what are the elements of this yoga? The yoga has a deity. This deity of this yoga, she is Goddess Lakshmi. So what does she do? We all know, you know, Diwali coming very close. We all know what Goddess Lakshmi is, who she is. In fact, the existence on this plane, or for that matter, any plane, would not be possible. Yeah, I take a moment off to tell you one of my legendary stories. So once, and it has a connect here, we will see. Once Lord Saturn and Devi Lakshmi got into a fight. So they were fighting on a fact that who has a better gait, who can walk in a better manner. Okay, so they went to everybody. Now, there's nobody on this entire who would have the liberty or who would have the courage to answer to either of them in negative. Because if Goddess Lakshmi went away from a person's life, the person would never even have the ability to eat a proper meal. And if Saturn moved into somebody's life, again, the person would not have the ability to eat a proper meal. So, they all would say, we really cannot understand you. Both are good. You both are good. Now, these two realize that they are all being diplomatic. And they get very angry and they ask, please tell us who has a better gait or else face our rot. So, one of the devatas who has some spine goes up to them and says that, Narad Rishi is the best person to ask. And we know Lord Narad is one of the best people. Why so? Because there's nobody more light, more loved than Lord Narad in all that of creation. He moves in all the worlds with equal ease and he's welcomed equally by the devatas, by the manushyas, and by the danavas. That is, by the gods, the devatas, by the humans and by the demons alike. So these people go up to him and say, please tell us who has the better gait. So Narad is like, okay, now it's my turn. I better be careful. So he says, please can you move that to that tree? Both of you can walk to that tree and come back. So both Devi Lakshmi and Lord Saturn, they both go walking up to a certain tree, come back. So they say, now please give us a correct answer. So Narad the Rishi, being the diplomatic person that he is, he bows to Goddess Lakshmi and Lord Saturn and says that, Goddess Lakshmi, you look beautiful when you're coming. And Lord Saturn, you look beautiful when you're going away. Well, this is the best answer you could find in the entire conversation that way. So they both laugh, they bless him with the bhakti of Lord Vishnu and they go their way.
I'm getting remembrance of a seminar where one of my gurus, he was telling that there are two kinds of people in this world. The first category, they bring happiness where they go. And the other category, they bring happiness when they go.
So this is the attribute. Now we will connect it when I move down to explaining the yoga, because every yoga has a yogi planet. That is a planet that gives a lot of beauty, a lot of love, a lot of protection, a lot of wealth, prosperity to that particular person. Okay. And Sahaya Yogi planet. That Sahaya Yogi planet acts as a helper to the Yogi planet. You know, it boosts up the Yogi planet. And as the Avayogi Yogi planet is the one, you know, the forces of nature have to be balanced. So every positive has to have a negative. So there is, to every Yogi, there is a Avayogi Yogi, or the one that counterbalances the protection. So whichever is strong will be powerful. Now, Goddess Lakshmi gives us health, wealth, prosperity. She is said to give 8 kinds of wealth, not just your money or assets. She is the Ashtalakshmi, which gives you children, which gives you knowledge, which gives you, you know, vehicles. She gives you the wealth as such. She gives you land, so many other things. And she is the goddess for good luck. There would be an increase in the fortune of a person who has a good Shubha Yoga after he or she gets married. She's always giving. She's one person that never stops giving. And yet, she's very humble. So when a person becomes more arrogant in this yoga starts diminishing for that person. We'll see. Okay? So now, the yogi planet in this chart again is Sun. The Sahayogi is Venus. And the Avayogi is Saturn. If you look at the chart carefully, you will have come to 3 conclusions straight on. When we were doing the Tithi, it was all about full moon and Saturn. Okay. And it was again with the division, it was again Saturn ruling the Purna. When we looked at the Vara, he was born on a Friday. And the ruling here, it was also with Vara, he was born on a Friday, and the Hora Lord then was of Sun. His Karna was Bhava, but the Lord was Sun, and the element is Mercury. And finally, but that is, element is common throughout, so we'll keep Mercury aside. The deity is also Sun, but that we'll keep the deity is Karna. In case of Karna, is Lord Vishnu. But let us just take, for his Karna, we'll take Bhava, that is Sun is the Lord here. We have done Nakshatra, Jeshta, Mercury comes into order. And again Saturn, because Saturn is common for all the Nakshatras. And finally, when we are talking about yoga, this is again yoga. So yoga, we have Sun, Venus and Saturn. So within so many planets, in the 9 planets that we are seeing, there are these 3 planets that are very predominant in his chart. The Sun, Venus and Saturn. Sun is very strong for him. Venus again is strong for him. Sun is very strong because Sun is in the 10th house. It's Digbali. It's just out of exaltation. It's in Taurus sign. It's a sign of commerce. There will definitely be a huge, huge impetus in his life all throughout with land, with money. And then it is associated with Rahu. Rahu in the 10th house will make you extremely ambitious and will, by hook or by crook, you have to reach the top. If Rahu is moving in a good octave, then you do for others and you gain. But when it is just about the ego, because here you see Rahu is an ego on the low note, lower octave. And Sun is ego when it is with malefics. So huge amount of ego. I mean, read it in this chart. And then we have the Sahayogi planet as Venus. Venus gives him a lot of support. And Sun is already sitting in the house of Venus. So he has gone ahead in life, done so much that it is, you know, generally not possible. And it is not possible for a person to do or gather so much of wealth by unfair means. Especially in the business that he was in. And then we have Saturn there, sitting in the 12th house. Saturn and Venus combination in the 12th house gives you recognition, gives you name, but it also causes a lot of problems from women. Because Venus is happy in the 12th house, it gets exalted in the 12th house of the natural zodiac. Again, it's a water sign here. So Venus is very happy here. But association with Saturn, there's definitely a lot of destructive influence of women. And we have seen that in his life, to be able to say that. His father was the one who handed him his business. Whenever the authorities, be it the taxation authorities, be it the wealth authorities, be it the revenue system, whenever they came, his father always made sure that there was an alibi ready for his child. But this Saturn, which is the Lord of the sixth house of litigation, Lord of the sixth house of employees, Lord of the sixth house of mistresses, has caused a lot of problems in his life. It's the Avayogi planet that gets you into a lot of problems, that removes that coverage or the protection from you. And it's sitting with the Sahayogi Venus. So that is why, as a Sahayogi, Venus has not been able, not allowed Saturn to rear its head that much. He's always suppressed those comments. He has been able to get that protection, but not for long. So this gets me into the Tithi Pravesh chart. This is what I told you earlier on, when the sun and the moon are exactly in the same degree as that of the chart, natal chart, in the same houses, in the same planet, the same nakshatras, that chart in crust is called the Tithi Pravesh chart. It is a huge, huge topic in itself, and you will have huge discussions on that, but I'm just going to stress on a very small point here. When his Tithi Pravesh was formed this year, though his birthday is somewhere in June, but this Tithi Pravesh was formed on 29th of May 218. That is, that day it was Purnima Tithi and this was formed. Now let's look at the placement of the Yogi and Avayogi planet for him. What I did was, every house is equal to 1 month.
I have one question here. You said Yogi and Avayogi planet. So you're like, for this year he is also born on Purnima, right?
Right.
Yeah, so you are taking from there.
Yeah, I'm taking this because the Yogi and the Avayogi, because the Yogi planet is a summation of the sun and the moon.
Okay.
So the sun and the moon are in the same degree.
Yes.
So the Yogi planet, so the yoga will remain the same. It will be Shubha Yoga only.
Yes.
And the Yogi planet will also be the same.
Yes.
And consequently, our Yogi planet, because it's the sixth planet from the Yogi planet.
And another question, this is available in Jagannath Hola, if I'm right.
Yes. I'll show you how to do that.
That's available for free in Jagannath Hola. So whoever is watching, they can get it. And which Ayanamsha are you using for this? Because there's Lahiri. This Pushya Paksha also.
Lahiri. I use Lahiri.
Lahiri, okay.
I use True Notes. And people use Mean Notes also. I use True Notes and I use Lahiri and Ayanamsha.
Yeah, because when I was in Frankfurt recently with one of my friends, he's also a great astrologer. So He was telling me that which one to use in Tithi Pravesh, this Pushya Paksha and Amsha or Lahiri. So if
No.
Lahiri is giving this, that's fine.
Yeah, Lahiri gives a good, as for so many years we've been doing, I've been doing Tithi Pravesh, and I have found that Lahiri gives a fair accuracy in predictions, fair amount of accuracy in predictions. So, what I was seeing was with transit, okay? So, I was seeing that in transit, Rahu is going to move over his Saturn around March, degreeically on March 15th. At the same degree on March 15th, and that is Punarvasu. So, Punarvasu Nakshatra means to do again. And Saturn, when it moves over Rahu, means change. Saturn and Rahu together can actually turn together if they're placed, turn things 180 degrees, God forbid. Back, okay? And then I wanted to check out if the March 15 has any show on his Tithi Pravesh. So what I did was, I moved on to his Tithi Pravesh. The March 15th would mean the 10th house operating for him. Okay? So when I moved into his 10th house, I see that on March 15th, his 10th lord is debilitated, is retrograde in the 5th house. And what does 5th house state? 5th house states that it, 5th house is also government agencies. So government agencies, which is also the 7th house of open oppositions, there are government agencies which are not trusting him and have litigations against him. So they are likely to raise their voice against him once again. Again, when we see that the 10th house in this case will be aspected by Rahu in transit also. Now in transit also. The 10th house is already being aspected by this Rahu, and in transit also by this Tithi Pravesh chart. That time also it would be under the radar. So there's a strong chance of him having a malefic aspect. And Saturn, which is his avayogi planet, is sitting and aspecting his lagna. Saturn is again, as per this chart, the 8th lord. And in the 8th house, we have Ketu and Mars sitting there. So all in all, it does not. In fact, there is a chance that he will have to lose power, or there will be a lot of problems created during that point in his life. In fact, there are huge chances that his health or security could be under a lot of pressure. So he would have to be very careful in those areas also, because Ketu and Mars, Ketu represents your problems, and Mars is also typically blood pressure, certain problems, fire, inflammation, the stomach and things like that. So health could be a major issue for him. His security could be a major issue for him. And the government agencies would definitely be after him in that case, because Sun, which is his avayogi planet, which was sitting in the 10th house till now in his natal chart, has moved in his Tithi Pravesh chart in the 12th house, which is again the house of losses, which is again the house of jails and such. So that creates a lot of problems for him. At this juncture, I would say all of us need to watch out for 15th, 10th to 20th of March, between these 10 days, as to what transpires and how it transpires in the life of Donald Trump. So that I would say is he would have to, you know, check out again as to how all of it unfolds in his life during the 10th to the 20th of March 2019.
And another thing I think is, if you take his ascendant itself, because he's a Leo Lagna, Right now, Mars, Ketu and Rahu Ketu are, Mars Ketu is in his 6th house and Rahu is transiting his 12th house, right, till March.
Right.
So I am very sure he is going through some really interesting time, because I know many Leo ascendants. They've been telling me that they are really having a difficult time, especially pertaining to their 6th house. So basically what is happening to 2-3 people I have talked, Leo ascendants, they have been telling me that, oh, we want to do something, but then we are forced to do something else. And yes, on 21st September, these two are exactly conjunct. So I had asked them what had happened, you know, Mars and Ketu, they were like this. So then I had asked them what had happened, and they said that that day or around 20th or 19th or 22nd, 23rd, they felt that we better not work only. Because whatever we want to do, we are feeling like headless, because Ketu is exactly in the same degree. So they are like, no, we better give up working only. So Leo ascendants, I know 2-3 of them, I have asked them, and they all have faced the same thing, irrespective of their dasa, I am saying. And depending on the dasa, it will decide, it will be more or less, but I have seen that.
See, because I do a lot of VCPs, so depending on the house that is running for you, that also matters. And yes, dasha, but remember that the transits have a say, great say, because they, as many people say, are the postman, the delivery of the yoga and dasha results. Secondly, whichever house Rahu and Ketu are transiting, okay, that is the house wherein you need to put in a lot of effort, because most of the things happening in your house could be related to those houses in your life at that moment, will be related to those houses.
Yeah, because Rahu Ketu represents the past life karma, the deepest of our past life karma. That is why Rahu Ketu are never stray. They are always retrograde. So that shows that they are bringing, the only thing they are doing is they are bringing your karmas from 10, then 11, then 12, 13, 100,000 lifetimes. They are bringing more and more karma from the back.
Yeah, and moreover, they, wherever they are sitting, right? So those karmas coming out, fulfill that house so they can move to the next house. Until and unless you die, they are moving, and so your karmas are not getting fulfilled ever. And just for records, if people remember what happened last time Rahu Ketu was there in the chart like this, check out, you will have a lot of similar instances.
Or especially, I have also seen in my experience, suppose you all already have some planets in the signs where Rahu Ketu, they are transiting. And then 18 years back, you see, now depending on the dasa, that can be different. But if suppose the ninth lord is placed in a sign where Rahu Ketu is transiting now, then it can happen that things related to your father become lively, the way it was lively in around 1998, 1999, that kind. So I have seen this in my experience, and I have also talked with people. So they have said that either the lordships, they have had some flavors, or the karakas, the natural karak. So if suppose Mercury, then uncle, or Venus, then lady, something of that sort happens every 18 years.
Yeah, if Mercury, then you start a new trading business. You had started a trading business 19 years ago, and now you're again starting a new trading business.
Or
Venus, then you come across a new female in your life. So, you know, these things will keep rotating like that with Rahu and Ketu. But seriously and honestly, as I feel, as Rahu is moving out, it's again Punarvasu Nakshatra that Saturn in this chart is placed in. Punarvasu means revisiting. Jupiter, the lord of that nakshatra, is retrograde during this phase. Saturn, which is placed in that sign, in that nakshatra, is retrograde during that phase of the time Tithi Pravesh, in the Tithi Pravesh chart. And also, during you know, that phase of 15th March that I'm talking about, Jupiter would be kind of going into retrogression, and Saturn is already, we've seen that in this chart it is, but Saturn here is retrograde, and there is going to be a hell lot for him to answer.
And I think the moment Rahu enters Punarvasu, he will start seeing the flavor.
Yes.
And especially the eclipse is also there on January 21st, I guess. It is in the Cancer Capricorn axis, which is again his 6-12 axis, if I'm correct.
Yes, so if that is happening, then now you know something. It's Rahu is in 1 degree for 18 days.
Yes.
So 18 into 3 plus add another 6 to the 20 minutes. So 18, that's 20, that is 60 days. Those
yes.
60 days are going to be paramount in his life.
And he might have to address some issue which he had left because on July 12th this year, there was this eclipse in Punarvasu. Mm. And my God, I can't believe it. I simply can't believe it. You know, I've seen so many people, they have started doing things which they had left long back. In fact, when I had come to Germany, I had started learning Deutsch, German. But then due to my work pressure and all this, I had left. And then exactly on, I think, 8th or 9th, I again restarted learning German. And so many people, one of my gurus I know, he used to stay in Chennai. And then what happened from last 8 years, he was in Kanpur. Okay. And that near about that time when I talked with him, after the eclipse, he said, "No, I am moving back to Chennai." I'm like, "My God, this is too much." One of my friend wanted to do MBA, but he did not do. And then after the eclipse, he said, "Oh, I am again starting my CAT MBA preparation." I'm like, "God knows what people are doing." So
this is a time, very trying times as well. And all this is, you know, you will see that the flavors. So, and we do the timing also with this, you know, of, you can say the timing of marriage, you can see the timing of your jobs, you can see the timing when there is going to be a bhagya there, everything through the Panchang. You don't need anything beyond the Panchang to do a reading. So who would have thought something that we use for so mundane a purpose, like just matching our charts or just seeing the good in the bad days, can yield so much of influence, so much of power in our lives. It's phenomenal.
Yeah, Panchang is something which, like when I went to Guwahati this time, I was talking to one of my chemistry teachers. He used to teach me in 11th and 12th. And we never talked in last 8 years from 2010. But suddenly one day he messaged me that, "Hey, it seems my 8th house has got active." And then I'm like, "What the hell is this person talking, man?" I'm like, 8th house has got active. And then this person, then he wrote, "Na, ha, ha, ha," he wrote like this. So then I was like, okay, that means he has seen me in YouTube.
Uh-huh.
So we were talking, when we went to Guwahati, we had a talk for around 6 to 7 hours in detail on astrology. And he has been studying astrology since 2002. Okay. So he told me that when he went to some places in India and when he asked about Panchang, then the astrologer started shouting on him, "Hey, why are you asking useless things? Panchang is not needed for all this. Panchang is only to see when are you getting married."
No, but why would anybody tell me, has it ever crossed anybody's mind as to why I would go to such elaborate process to get so much information out just for mundane stuff like good dates and bad dates and marriage matching? Does it not hold a much wider perception? Have you ever questioned? Now there's another way of doing, just by that Panchang, there's within that Panchang a lot of other information available that would tell you how your life is going to unfold in every single year. But we will continue that discussion in some other case, Bhavajit. And
yeah, and in fact, so many times it happens, no? People ask that, "Oh, he was born hours before." You like, when I was in Ujjain, I had met Krishna Guruji. So one of my very initial subscribers, Preeti Phalke, she had come. And she had also, with her, she also brought the district collector, I think sub-district magistrate, SDM they say, of Ujjain district.
Okay.
So then he came and Preeti ji told me, "Hey, he's just born one day before you." Okay, and then I'm like, okay, let's check the horoscope. Everything is same, you know, but then still so many things are different. Like Panchang is totally different.
See, the moon.
No, the nakshatra and everything is same.
No.
So then only the lagna is different. Lagna is different, and Panchang elements, they are different. So they made the difference.
The lagna is different. The moon has moved away from a degree, certain degree, right? The nakshatra might be the same, but the degree of the moon has changed.
Yes.
And
yes.
So that changes the tithi. It could change the tithi. It could change the vara is already changed. If the tithi
yes.
is placed, the karana changes. If there's a change in place of the moon and the sun, the your nakshatra, the yoga changes. So when the yoga also changes, so in effect, you think the planets are in the same place.
Yeah, that's what.
The elements of Panchang has changed. So many things in your life will absolutely not be the same. In fact, very few things except for the mental attitude, because your nakshatra is the same. So only the mental attitude will remain same. Other things will change dramatically.
Yeah, as one of my seniors once said, no? Panchang will tell you what to look in the chart.
Exactly. So you see, in Donald Trump's chart, would any of us have said the Sun, Venus and Saturn are the most important planets? But when we are analyzing the Panchang, we come to that conclusion and we know that this time and again, the time when Sun would move on to, Rahu moves on to Taurus. And Saturn has already moved on in that time during, you know, in Capricorn. They are in trine. Trine is a very strong bond. That time also, this is the Rahu return time. And that time again, he will have a major upheavals in life. So, not that I wish him so. He's a human being. He deserves to be happy. But that is what the chart is saying as regards him.
And I think 2020 November, when the elections are there, Rahu will enter his 10th house that time, I guess.
So we'll
because now it will enter his 11th, and then after 18 months, there's election. After March, mm-hmm. I mean,
yeah.
November, it's almost 2 years from now. So then Rahu will enter his 10th house. So I don't know if you have made any analysis, but what do you think on that 2020? Yeah,
we know for a fact, you can see it from his chart. When Rahu moves over his sun and as in trine with Saturn, there's going to be a lot of upheaval. Don't forget that it is also a Rahu return for him. When Rahu returns, it brings about a huge, tremendous amount of loads of karmic debt with him.
Oh, okay.
So till now he was reaping from his past benefits. But then there will be time when the armor, because again, I am of the view that the more good you do, the more strong your chart becomes, you know. And the more bad you do, the more you diminish the value of all the planets, of all the yogas in your chart. So not that he's been doing a lot of good to himself or to others. So at the end of the day, there has to be, you know, some balance of it. Not for me to say that, but that is what comes across. And if you really want to learn more, Babaji, anybody willing to learn more, I have a course coming up in Panchang, you know, from the 4th of November. So
yeah, they you can, whoever is watching this and is interested, they can always enroll to Madam's course. Now, then you will understand each and every area in detail, how, and you can also get the list for all the deities and all their devatas, and then you can also analyze it, because if you understand the principle, then you can also analyze your own chart and different charts, of course, but we have to understand how to do that.
And it's the only time when I'm giving a composite course. What I thought I would do it into 15 weeks as a course is turning out to be a 6 months course, and I still do not know how I am going to compress it into 6 months. It's such a huge syllabus. So from the next time, I will divide the syllabus into three. But for now, it's a total course on all the five elements of the Panchang.
Fantastic. So next session should be on what? On nakshatra, on vara, or on tithi?
Okay, we will leave it on to our viewers. whatever they say, they can opt for yoga, they can opt for karana, nakshatra, vara, tithi, whatever they opt for, we'll take a pick and we'll come to that.
Okay, so in another month, whoever writes in comments, I will take a poll and I'll just give marks. Tithi 5, karana is 2, then yoga is maybe 100, so then we will do on yoga.
But you know, yoga is very beautiful here. Again, we just take that. Yoga is very beautiful because, as I said, look at Mercury. Everything born on the Ekadashi, ruled by the Vishwadevatas. Huge amount of ability to do work, did work, stood herself out, but born on a yoga such that constant struggles in life. So it's a very powerful effect that you will, you know, see. Major, major effect, because again, it's a Jupiterian energy working, the ether, the ability to spread, be good. As a guru, dev guru, you know, give protection, form of a kavach, everything. So, anybody who wants to, I am game for all the five elements of the Panchang. Or if you want to do any one particular nakshatra, I'm game for that also. All yours to say.
Okay, so if you are interested, then you can visit her website, and she also does consultations, and she has a beautiful YouTube channel also, about which I forgot to mention as usual in the beginning.
No worries. And if you people want to read about Donald Trump in detail, this article on Donald Trump will be up on my website for anybody to read.
Yeah, I will post a link in the comments also, so that whoever has watched, not watched till the end, they can also get benefit from that. Okay, thank you very much for coming. It was so long, my God. But it's very interesting sometimes where we can combine so many things, because generally in astrology, we see generally that we are just focusing, okay, he's running this dasha, this will happen. This planet is here in D1, in D10, in D9. So then we go become very specific. But this kind of thing is also very important. Like I was having a talk with Vishti Larson that day. So he was telling, if Jupiter is more prominent in your chart, then you will like to have bird's eye view of the horoscope first. But if you have Sun, Mars more prominent, then you will be like, oh, do hell with other details. He's asking about marriage. I will only see marriage.
Exactly. So it depends upon where your energy is more focused.
Yes. So I think today was more of a bird's eye view and connecting the entire chart. And that's why people, when they ask, this full reading is this much, it's that much, it's this many hours. But I'm like, oh, for full reading, maybe it will go to 8 hours, 12 hours, no, one person alone.
Yes. So so when I'm doing a Panchanga analysis, which is also a service available, it takes a minimum of 100 minutes, 1 hour, 40 minutes. Because you want to know every aspect. Like we have covered for... we have covered for Donald Trump, it's between 1 hour, 20, 40 minutes, 30 minutes. And there's still so much more, like the timings. We have not taken into account the timing as to when, you know, relationships will matter and when career will prosper, when there will be a turnaround in his life. We've not done those things.
Interesting. Very interesting. We'll do more sessions next time. Maybe we can take some other chart and do, because now we don't have to give the theory. The theory people already know, so we can just directly do some for half an hour that is tithi, then each and every element is saying this, so this is how likely the person is supposed to enjoy or suffer, maybe.
Definitely, we'll do that, and with great pleasure. Till we meet again.
Right.
Bye.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.